So welcome everybody to our, I guess this is the third of our guest speaker series, and tonight we're very happy to have three speakers from the National Gallery of Victoria representing the Marketing and Audience Engagement Department. And what we have, of course, is these people communicating their journey of how they've embraced marketing, challenges faced in marketing in the context of issues around the National Gallery. And they're going to lead us through the journey that they've undertaken and share their experiences. And there'll be an opportunity for you to ask some questions. Okay, so I'll hand it over to Donna, Helen and Elisha.
Hi everyone. Thank you. Please let us know if you can't hear us. I think pretty much we all have a cold at the moment, as does everybody at the NGV at least. So we are here representing the Audience Engagement Department of the NGV. So none of us is a marketer, which might be interesting in its own right to sort of explore that a bit further. But we definitely face challenges with our consumers, or with our audiences as we call them, and kind of trying to bring our audiences closer to what we do and closer to our mission at the NGV. But that mission itself has changed dramatically even within the last 5 years. So at the moment we're trying to, I guess, realign our mission with our audience. So it's a very interesting time of change that the NGV is going through. So our department, Audience Engagement, takes care of a lot of customer-facing aspects of the NGV, primarily through all of our programming initiatives, through our membership department, and through our front of house department, who basically are the touch points with our visitors physically at the gallery. So we're very visitor focused, but having said that, we behind the scenes collaborate a lot with a lot of other departments, and really we couldn't do anything that we do at the NGV in terms of what we present to our audiences without a whole range of collaborations that go on behind the scenes. So probably for us, number one is collaboration is really the key. In terms of getting our messages out to our audiences and also inviting them into the gallery itself. So we thought today we could share with you maybe some of our current challenges and opportunities, and invite you to quiz us on any of those, you know, give us your thoughts as well. I'm not sure if you're visitors of the NGV, and that would be quite interesting to get your perspective as well from your professional approach as well as your personal connection with the gallery, and whether or not what we're talking about sort of matches with your own experience. So very happy for that to happen throughout the discussion as well. So I head up the Audience Engagement Department. Helen is our senior programmer and also looks after our membership area, and Elisha is our senior audience engagement officer and really looks at a whole range of strategies and initiatives to engage visitors from a non-programming perspective, so much more in terms of strategy and sort of publishing, connecting with social media, and those non-physical kind of touch points as well. So we thought we'd go through, we've got some words which I can't really see, but number one, we thought it would be interesting to, I suppose, talk through what exactly is the NGV. And it seems like a very simple question. Of course, it's an art museum. It contains, 70,000 works of art. But at the moment, and for the past few years at least, we've really been rethinking what the NGV is.
And yeah, I think in terms of programming, in terms of all of our facets of all of the touch points that we have with our visitors, we've been trying to rethink that and think about that strategically, and trying to build, I suppose, a new identity around the NGV, but not losing those old traditional points of views that visitors hold so dear. I'm not from Victoria, but I know that there's a lot of older audiences who remember going as a child, you know, touching the water wall. So all of those elements, we don't want to lose that. But then what's the NGV going forward, and what's the NGV today, and what's the NGV of the future? I think we're all trying to consider that. And what you'll find is that that's actually something that's involving every single department of the NGV. So it's, although it's a, you know, a marketing question, it's a brand question, it's one that is touching every single department, from conservation to public programs to media. It's one that we're all in it together, and we're all considering together and working towards together, which is really quite incredible when you work in such an organisation like that.
It's interesting because, as Donna said, we're not actually within the marketing department, and we do work very, very collaboratively with marketing as well. I think in some ways you could say it's almost a next generation of marketing. You know, in the NGV, gone are the days, I suppose, where the marketing department existed purely to service the promotional needs of other departments, but now there's a lot of overlap between marketing and promotion and also programming, especially with the advent of more digital communities and people engaging with us via those platforms. There is definitely a lot of blurring of the lines. People want to find out about what events we have and what exhibitions we have and what we have to offer, but they're also interested just in learning more about our art or connecting with like-minded people as well. So it's very much a holistic approach, I suppose, to all aspects of engaging with different people at the gallery, whether it's through digital communications, print communications, programming actually on the ground in the gallery, or I suppose extended virtual programming as well. I think that one big thing that galleries and museums always have to sort of tussle with is the balance of engaging with the community and putting the audience first, but also respecting the integrity of the art, especially as a collecting institution, as the National Gallery is. And so to offer really high quality programs that really enable a more intimate, in-depth access to art and its relevance in a contemporary world, but also making it very, very relevant and just very interesting and enjoyable for a wide range of people as well.
So I suppose, you know, the gallery itself is, yes, it's a physical place that you can go to, and there's a range of things that you can do there. But increasingly, especially with the advent of many more digital platforms, the idea of physically visiting is now not a requirement. It's not a necessity to engage with us. So we sort of, yes, we'd like you to come through the door, but you don't have to if you can't, or if you're not interested in doing that, but you want to engage with the collection in some other way. So you might perhaps read you know, a piece on an artwork in our magazine that might be a perspective of a creative writer about that work. Not everything needs to come through those sort of agreed channels, you know, that art historians talk about art. We're certainly not interested in that anymore. So many of our visitors do come through the door, but there are many people who also just, you know, engage with us digitally as well. And so it's a very interesting time for museums in that balance that Elisha was talking about respecting why we were invented in the first place and where we're going to end up in the future. And all of that sits really in the hands of our visitors or our customers. And so where we end up is sort of that relationship and how that all sort of pans out. So it's a very interesting time. Certainly, you know, our department and these types of departments are quite new in art museums as well. And having professionals specifically looking at this very grey area is starting to become a little bit of a kind of profession in its own right, which it never had been before.
And I think as well, stemming from that, one of the points that we keep coming back to is the audience. And one of the things that we're hoping to, one of our sort of challenges and opportunities is really starting to understand our audience, you know, be it that audience that is a digital based audience that may not have actually stepped foot into the gallery, or be it an audience that is a long time member, or an audience that just attends programs or just visits exhibitions. You know, we have a diverse range of audiences, and we're continuously seeking to try and better understand these audiences. So, you know, there's a multiple different platforms at which we're starting to understand and starting to gather information. We've just implemented some new CRM, is that what it's called? A database system called Tessitura, and you can pull statistics based on, you know, people booking in for certain programs and where they found out about it, you know, postcodes. So all of this sort of information we can start to gather. It's just a matter of us, I suppose, our next opportunity is, well, how best do we, are we informed by this, and how best do we use that to then implement a, you know, a marketing plan, or how does this inform our brand and our understanding of our brand or our programming? So there's lots of opportunities there with us to really consider who our audience are and actually use that research and that evidence base that we're developing and collecting now.
We have arranged, say, to take it back a step and to look at how we evaluate or find out who our audiences are. We take part in a whole range of sort of cultural research projects, and we work with a research company specifically looking at our visitation, who are our audiences, where are they coming from, how often do they come, do they come back, what is their sort of cultural heritage, what is their age. And we were talking about this earlier, actually we rarely use any of that information, so it's interesting to have it, but at this stage those metrics aren't really telling us much about engagement. So they're telling us a whole range of facts, but what are they actually telling us about a true relationship with our visitor? And so we're kind of in this interesting place where it's almost like the metrics haven't caught up to the customer yet. Those traditional metrics, they cover off reports for government about how many people came through the door, but they don't really do much more than that. And so we kind of maybe feel like we have to come up with some new metrics or some new ways of thinking about how our visitors or our customers are engaging with us and how our brand is working. And actually, a lot of that comes via social media. And so we learn so much even by the comments that people are making on our Instagram feed, you know, how that is growing over time, what images people are responding to. So we're sort of taking a lot more of that, you know, sort of qualitative research or information, which I suppose could be really dismissed on a whole range of levels. But actually, that's where we're finding a whole lot of useful information at the moment, and maybe in balance with that other quite statistical information about, you know, the visitation itself. So again, it feels like we're in a very sort of nascent period where all of this is really changing.
I think a lot of that comes down also to starting to value our other audiences more. So as Donna said, it's not so much, it's not as, it's equally as important, I suppose, to look at our remote audiences or our social media audiences, as well as our traditional feet through the door audiences. And I think through the process of, I suppose, coming up with different measures of success that take into account this more contemporary way of engaging audiences, I think by default it also enables us to show that we highly value and respect these audiences as well, and that we are creating experiences and opportunities for these very specific audiences. Also, we one thing that we're quite interested in finding more about is, I suppose, a crossover between our digital audiences and the people that come in to the gallery. And we don't know a whole lot about that because we don't actively measure our digital audiences unless, for example, we happen to know that they're members, which, you know, we don't. But this new system that Helen mentioned to Satura, you know, has a lot of opportunity there, but we haven't fully exploited or explored that yet.
So I guess these kind of, just on that previous slide, sorry, Elisha, these are the kinds of, I suppose, the kinds of discussions we have internally about what we do with our colleagues as well. And as I said, it's sort of, it really is quite a sort of blurry area, which is what we really like, and which is why we're attracted to it. In a physical sense, how we actually realise we have, you know, a problem or an opportunity, and how we work through that with our colleagues. Sort of everything that we do really stems from the gallery's program, and so we work quite true to a sort of about a 5-year schedule, where we sort of know what is coming up ahead of us, and that programming is developed with our curatorial team, but then there's very early input from lots of other departments. We have a sort of winter and a summer period. For those of you who are visitors, you might have recognised this winter is a little more of the traditional arts, so the Melbourne Winter Masterpieces exhibition series. Summer has really shifted and has become our contemporary art and design focus. So you get this kind of seasonal approach, I suppose, and that exhibition program very much reflects that into the future. And then we work with individual artists in terms of profiling contemporary or older artists as well, to really highlight their practice over time. So sort of like a survey exhibition or a retrospective of an individual artist's work. And then we have the permanent collection, which is permanent, but then within that as well, there are small displays where we, for instance, we had an exhibition focused on the idea of the horse last year. And so it so happened that there were many thousands of artworks in the collection that had either, you know, imagery or stories or histories related to the horse. And so we brought that out as a thematic exhibition from the collection. And so we're continuously looking at this schedule. The ideas themselves can really come from anywhere. For instance, we also hold an art book fair, which is coming up at the end of this month. And that idea came actually from our senior publications coordinator. And so now it's a staple in our annual program. Every year we'll have this art book fair where we bring together practitioners for the general public and sort of augment with that with a range of programs. So it's not like a really top-down approach to the ideas. We also know that there are problems inherent perhaps with that seasonal approach too, in that, you know, if somebody who is interested in historical art comes in winter, does that mean they're not going to come in summer? And how do we get them to come in summer? So we have to think about those kind of ideas as well. So it's, I guess it's a lot of brainstorming with our colleagues. We do look at some of this data that we have, but we look at our observations as well. We spend a lot of time actually on the floor looking at what people are doing, finding out from our front of house visitor information officers too what feedback they're getting, and then responding to that as we need to as well.
So these are some of the questions, I guess, that
we're coming up against. And they're very interesting because as the gallery is changing, and we're trying to seek this balance between not losing that audience that we've built since the 1860s and moving into this sort of 21st century era where it's sort of all about you know, truer engagement and a real dialogue with our visitors. The gallery itself, its brand, has changed quite dramatically. And the expectation as to what we are, who is the NGV, is actually, it's a problem and an opportunity for us. So we're trying to protect the brand as much as change it and force it to change at the same time. And we're noticing a broadening, obviously, in our audience, but then also in terms of our networks and those who are interested in working with us. So we're actually getting a lot more interest. And so when it comes to collaborating with external either companies or individuals, we have to go back to, you know, who are we again, and we're trying to work that out actually. Who are we alongside this interest as well, and to try and protect again the brand also while opening up the brand as well.
And interestingly, it's also collaboratively working with departments. So for example, corporate partnerships might have one party interested in collaborating, but does it align with programs? You know, actually talking clearly with corporate partnerships and public programs together to come up with, you know, a sort of strategic understanding of what is it that we're looking for in this collaboration. You know, is it going to add value to our programs or to our audience base? So actually working with each department really closely on certain case examples to really come to, I suppose, an understanding, a holistic understanding, rather than have them as ad hoc. Okay, well, this suits programs, but does it actually suit marketing's needs? No. So then does it actually work in this instance holistically? Probably not. So actually looking at it that way, rather than in silos of departments, I think is something that we're really often really trying to put forward as well and work towards. I think that also ensures that everyone at the gallery is working towards this one understanding of the NGV brand, whatever it may be. you know, we're sort of working towards that together rather than individually. Yeah.
And workshopping it together.
Yeah.
Because it is very much a journey. And I think, you know, most of you are probably aware, it's a wonderful benefit of collaboration is more opportunities arise. You see more synergies and parallels between things. And I suppose you have a wider range of skills as well that can contribute to a project and a wider range of talent. I know that certainly my role couldn't exist without an incredible level of collaboration with other departments internally, even more so, I suppose, than externally, whereas, you know, there are other positions within the NGV that are more outward focused, but I don't think any role would exist to its fullest potential without that level of collaboration and ongoing dialogue with other departments as well, and working towards a holistic idea of a project or a vision.
And I guess the effect of all of this, I mean, this is, I think, the end of our sort of provocations, but this this idea about how do we commission, create, curate and manage content is one that we're very much in the thick of at the moment, because as the gallery changes and really our interface with the public is through a lot of our digital platforms, we create a lot of content. Everyone creates content all the time, and we're sort of at the time now where we're thinking about how does all of that content reflect who we are or who we want to be. And so we've sort of, in the past, everything we've created, just sort of thrown on our website. And you know, you can find your way through it. It's all very important stuff. But it hasn't been sort of seen strategically or developed strategically. So an effect of that is at the moment we're really thinking about, well, you know, what do we film? Who do we interview? Do we put more resources into content or capturing content that we see to be truly reflective of where we want to go, rather than interviewing all these people or recording all this stuff, and actually it really doesn't have a purpose. So we might even remove some stuff from our website. I think we will, as part of this process, and then enter into more of a sort of editorial phase where we're actually curating content for that platform specifically. You know, we do it with social media all the time. All of that that messaging is specifically curated for that platform. And yet there's a whole section of our business where we're still just sort of working it out. So that's a really big one for us at the moment. And then I guess, happy for your questions and insights, but then we just have a slide which is just to give you a sense of how our audiences are engaging with us, you know, on those various platforms as well.
And that's increased enormously as well. I think one of the challenges we've faced with content is that not only are we producing more and more content, but we've got more platforms as well. And the website being a major platform, I suppose, internally in some ways, there's been an expectation that all of the good content or the important content needs to be funneled through to the website more often than not in the same form. Whereas, as you can see here, we've got so many other opportunities and different ways to engage with our audience. And you know, we're just starting to look at how we can strategically commission and create content for these different platforms, and some items might be used in one area and others in another area, or it might be created across a few different platforms as well.
And what we're also finding, just on that point as well, is that sometimes, you know, our audiences are reacting to certain content on certain platforms. For example, LinkedIn we found has been a really interesting platform for certain types of programs, so programs that might include business voices or interest, that sort of professional clientele has often had quite a big intake and interest through LinkedIn. And so actually starting to understand our audiences through, I suppose, those programming interests and those various platforms, including, you know, LinkedIn and Twitter and Instagram.
And there's what comes with all of that content and all of these exhibitions is that we're all vying to get our message out there to the visitor, and it can result in a complete oversaturation. So every single time we're asking someone to come in to buy a ticket, to do this, to do that, we also have to include content in there which is just purely about the art as well and why someone might find that interesting. So again, it's that balance of getting people through the door, and then these other ways that are really valuable ways of engaging with us, but they're really hard to track and they're really hard to measure or kind of quantify why they're important. So we're quite interested in that area. We're happy to take any questions.
Just one thing to add, I think, which is interesting here in the MBA marketing few people have a marketing background. I think it's interesting to share your own personal backgrounds, because mm-hmm. I think it's quite enlightening to see who's working in marketing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I have a background in art history. I guess maybe as a child I thought I'd be an artist and then realised that's very hard, that takes a lot of courage, and I think it rarely pays off, so hats off to anyone who can make it work. So I have a pure art history background. I entered the museum sector at around the age of in my early 20s, and I actually worked in a curatorial field and sort of realised that what I was more interested in than acquiring or exhibiting works was how people could connect with them. And I was always interested in art, and I hate the idea that people might feel excluded from art. So the idea that they might connect with it in some way, or that I might be able to help them understand it, was something that I felt very passionate about. So I very quickly moved into programming.
And my background's actually, interestingly, quite similar to Donna's. So I did a Bachelor of Art History and Theory, and then closely followed by a Master's of Art History and Curatorship, so looking at museum studies in particular, and did a curatorial internship back in Sydney, where I'm from. But when it was during that curatorial internship, I realised I didn't want to be a curator. I think to be a curator, again, like being an artist, it takes this particular type of personality. I think you have to be really... you have to have a lot of belief in your personal ideas that come forth in an exhibition, and I just wasn't sure that I had that in me, but I was more interested in the artistic ideas that were being developed and being communicated through the artworks, and I really thrived on that engagement with the artists, and I've always have, and I've always been passionate about the arts since an early age as well. So I started to think about what else is there for me that still engages with art but is not a curatorial voice. And luckily there was a really great learning department at the museum I was doing my internship at, and I was able to, I suppose, bounce into MCA learning and really start to learn about engagement and audience visitor engagement with the arts. I did a lot of teaching as well, and I actually did my teaching degree in secondary high schools and taught visual arts for 2 years in secondary schools. And that for me was a pathway which, you know, although it wasn't in the gallery sector, it still was around this idea of access to arts and discussing art and empowering students through art. And I think that's something that I've always held true. And in programming now, I'm really happy to be back in the gallery, because I did miss that, and I thrive on that world of being around the artists, being around a dynamic institution and being surrounded by art. But in programming, I'm constantly looking at opportunities to engage people with works, to engage in ideas, to engage in topical discussions. And that's what I'm really enjoying, and that's what I was really hoping for when I started my career, and what I constantly am looking for too in the future.
My story is similar but different. I studied creative arts, which really is a mixture of various different applied arts and art history and theory, and included creative writing, so I've always been interested in language and story. I've only been at the NGV for a year, and before that my background was in arts, but it was in the non-profit sector, which is quite different. Very, very small, very, very collaborative as well. I grew up on a farm in the country, but I've always loved the arts, and I've always loved stories, I suppose. In my mind, the two have always sat together, and I've often wondered how can somebody like myself, who just grew up in the middle of nowhere, have come to fall in love with something as specific as art. And to me, I suppose I was attracted to the idea of other worlds and places I couldn't imagine without, I suppose, the visual arts and the idea of the story sort of opening those windows for me. When I finished university, I worked, as many people do, for a while in various completely non-related arts jobs, And then I got my first break in a small publishing company. Again, it wasn't art, so it wasn't particularly interesting, to be honest. And then, as serendipity had it, I moved to Western Australia and I got a wonderful job for a small non-for-profit there, and I had a wonderful mentor as well, who was quite instrumental in taking me under her wing. And I did a stint in curatorial over there as well, and sort of like Donna and Helen, I sort of realised I was more interested in talking about and exploring why we like art and what is that human connection, why do we continue to either make art or look at art, or even beyond the art itself, why are we interested in stories and the visual world. So I sort of started to move away from the exhibition side of things and more into working directly with people, but also working very behind the scenes in the research and the strategy side of things as well.
You'll find that we're very curious people, like we're very interested in a lot of things, and we just want to bring out the stories in everything, I suppose. And it's quite interesting, it's common across like my team in programmers, they're just constantly kind of asking questions and really excited by the opportunity to learn more.
Actually, Helen, could you provide an example of like a programming designed to create engagement, just so that people who don't visit the gallery much, you get a sense of what that looks like?
Sure, I'm trying to think of which one to use. I think I can provide two examples, because I think you actually look, it's quite important to look at programming in a variety of sort of streams. So if we look at sort of social programming, you obviously know about Friday nights, which I won't use as an example, but Summer Sundays I think is a really interesting example. So in February, for four Sundays over the February from 1 to 6 p.m. we had a variety of sort of performances and live music in the NGV Garden. It was set underneath the Summer Architecture Commission. So it was providing sort of a social opportunity for audiences to come enjoy the garden, which is a space that only really has been, I suppose, recently revitalised. And what we're trying to do as a gallery is really reposition the garden as a meeting spot for people and really encourage people to come and use the space. It's a free space. It's just at the end of the NGV International, you know. It's a lovely space. It's a warm space. It's a welcoming space. So that Summer Sunday series was really situated there to encourage people to come and to enjoy the space, to take a breather from the exhibition period, the busy exhibition period of Andy Warhol Ai Weiwei. And it was a chance to align, I suppose, music audiences as well with the gallery. And so we had a headline act by an emerging musician each week, just for an hour. And we had local DJ sets and just food and beverage offerings. So it wasn't heavy in terms of programming like talks or lectures, but it was an informal setting. And a lot of work was done with variety of teams to make that happen. So obviously we worked with our assets and facilities teams to actually make it set up properly, but we did a lot of behind the scenes work with exhibitions design to make it look strong, to make it look connected to the exhibition brand. So all of the signage, all of the staging was all integrated into one look and feel, so that you felt as a visitor that it was all connected and you felt like it wasn't an ad hoc sort of stage setting. And then a lot of the marketing obviously followed then that brand and was strategically placed throughout the city. And so that's one sort of program which I suppose we know is in our calendar. It's pretty much solidly there. And it's those conversations early on with a variety of teams to think about, okay, well, it's going to be here. How will we make that happen? What will it look like? What will it feel like? What will it sound like? And let's tie that all together and make it then happen.
Maybe a good just addition to that is how we leverage other brands, I suppose, within that program as well. So we did this year a collaboration with Gelato Messina. Summer and ice cream go together, and obviously they then did a whole lot of marketing of our event, really their event as well. And I think we reached out to their audience quite successfully, and also a partnership with Asahi Beer as well. So we kind of, both of those brands, which sat within the marketing as well, gave you the feeling that, okay, it's at the NGV, it's in the garden, there's music, there's ice cream, there's beer, you know, there's a whole lot of stuff going on there. So we really leveraged those opportunities with working with those sort of partners as well.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, Gelato Messina named their ice creams after Warhol and Weiwei as well. So Warhol and Weiwei, yes. So that was good as well. It was good for the exhibition brand. And I suppose just on another note, an academic program, which is quite a different style program. So for our major exhibitions, we often look at doing a lecture series, for example. And so what we try to do in our early planning stages is we often have really quite deep, intense briefings with the curators who develop the exhibitions. We talk to them about key ideas, key themes, but we also do our own independent research. So it might be around the period of the, you know, the art movement that's going on. It might be socio or historical factors that are going on at the time of the artist practice and their work. So we often do a lot of research around those kind of topics, and then we start to think, okay, well, what is another, what's a series of lectures that we could do that would value add to the visitor experience? Because obviously we don't want to do a series of lectures that's just about the work that's on display, because people will just see that in the exhibition. So what's another, series of conversations that we can add on? And that's how we approach normally our sort of academic style programming or our talk style programming. So we'd then do research into speakers from various universities or institutions who might be able to speak on a variety of topics and ideas. And then we look at situating them into a series of maybe three or four lectures, depending on the nature of the exhibition. And that audience base is really quite varied, but often a lot of members come to those lecture series because they're quite an actively engaged audience in those sort of lecture series formats. And we often try to bring in new audiences through engaging diverse speakers as well. So, you know, there are a lot of speakers that we've engaged previously many, many years in lectures, and we're trying to always, use a variety of voices now rather than just the one art history academic who knows everything, but
it's very boring.
It's quite dry. Yeah. Two approaches, yeah. I suppose. Donna, did you have anything else to add?
I suppose now we're really branching out beyond, you know, what you might think is our core mission to collect and exhibit art and to educate people about it. So another two examples might be our teens art party, which we just held last week.
That was great.
Had 1,500 teenagers come to the gallery after hours and basically a kind of Friday night style, but for teens. And there were some hands-on workshops, performances, silent disco, access to Warhol Weiwei, food that they would eat.
A
dance floor, which was very popular. And that kind of giving over of the museum to that new audience is something quite new for us as well. And again, it's on that social end of the spectrum, but really it's the exhibition and the content of that is really what's driving it. So that's what we want to get out there to the audience. We're just trying to meet them in terms of their own interests. Mm. So that's an example of that. Another one might be we're doing now an annual International Women's Day panel discussion, where we're sort of leveraging again those corporate partnerships and really getting the sort of top tier of female business leaders or from a range of fields, and actually using the gallery as a site to have these discussions that are broader than the art. We always ensure there's a creative person on the panel, but we work with ABC Radio National to host and record and broadcast the event. And so now we're trying to sort of situate the NGV as a place where these broader discussions can happen, and that we're a topical site and we're interested in content beyond, you know, our little kind of turf. Mm. Yeah.
Questions from the audience?
I'm interested in knowing what reference points you go to or utilise in actually coming up with content. I've been reading it, listening to you wrong, or reading it wrong. So the curators come up with the ideas in terms of what you're going to show at the gallery.
Mostly. We have a kind of, a committee format in terms of our exhibition scheduling. And so ideas come up through that committee. But again, those ideas can come from anywhere. So the example, say, of the Art Book Fair coming from our publications team. So that has really rigorous content, but not from a curatorial side. Everybody travels and sees art. And so we're always sharing with each other what we've seen. And so, groups of people might acquire or propose artworks who have nothing to do with the curatorial team. So
generally, though, our curatorial team are experts in their particular fields, and so we work kind of, I suppose, a little geographically and a little kind of content-driven. So we have a department of prints and drawings and photography, but then an international art department. So it kind of, it's a mixture of media and sort of geography. And so they are always working on how to make the collection, you know, more interesting and different, because you can't just trottle out the same content with the same five paintings every year. People will completely switch off. Yeah, we're sort of, the ideas sort of come from everywhere, but the curatorial content sort of is generated from that department. And then in those briefings that Helen spoke about, they're held really, really early on, and often before even the checklist of works is finalised. So we're always badgering the curators for, you know, what's the list of works, what's the list of works, and they haven't even formulated it in their own minds yet, because we want to get in right at the start. And actually those discussions can formulate the themes of the exhibition sometimes as well. And that's certainly how we work with our marketing team too. We don't just come up with programs and then hand them on for them to get an audience. We actually like to have a discussion with them about the programs. So it's kind of, yes, there are demarcations, but they're really, again, quite blurred.
Because I was interested, I mean, these are very impressive statistics up here. What's the number of people through the front door every year?
Around 2.4 million.
Yeah, 2.4 million.
But that's only been quite recent. Say 3 years ago, 4 years ago, it was 1.4. So.
And that's what you're judged on in terms of funding and...
Look, a lot of the time, yes, definitely, and I'm not sure, unless someone comes up with some other amazing metrics, it really is, definitely. We have a government grant that we receive, but that's actually been frozen for a number of years, so we grow, but that stays the same, and so there's a higher expectation for us to actually generate our own income, either through ticket sales, through our corporate partnerships, and through private philanthropy. So we're getting much more active in that, and I think that work is really what's generating those increases in the numbers, and the fact that everyone's interested in audiences now. You know, we don't just want to tick them through the door, we actually want to do something, you know, more meaningful with them. But unfortunately, I think that number is generally, you know, a lot of the time that's what you're, you know, you're kind of judged on.
Yeah. So you were talking about the online and the intangible touch points that the NGV has with its customers. What is sort of the online experience that the NGV offers, and are you working on anything new, or any directions that you're going in?
Experiences.
An interesting case study is not one specific project, but we work quite closely again with the marketing department on social media and a range of small projects within the social media realm, particularly Instagram, that are not promoting a program, they're not promoting an exhibition, but they're really about, I suppose, a small scale human experience as well. We've been running a hashtag project called My NGV for a little while. And that involves either we interview some an interesting array of people who have come into the gallery, and they tell us in, you know, very small amount of words what work they like from our collection, you know, what they really love here, what they love about the NGV. Often it might not even be an artwork, it might be the building itself. The water wall is incredibly popular. The ceiling in the Great Hall is very popular, and people have a very strong sense of connection and nostalgia. So we like to tease out through this small project these elements of, I suppose, as I mentioned before, the more human connection with the art and with the NGV. And we also run in the gallery magazine, I suppose, a more in-depth print version of that. So we have a My NGV series every issue, which has a more extended story around some sort of interesting character in the community, and they may not be directly linked to the arts, but often they are linked to the NGV in some way, and they'll tell us about a work in the collection that you know, has really resonated with them through their life, and often the stories are quite lovely, and it really enables you know, audiences to look at work differently, and to find, I suppose, parallels and to find stories they may not see through other platforms or other avenues as well. So we've got a lot of little things like that on social media, and some other ones sort of on the back burner as well.
I think, Elisha, you did an interesting little trial with International Museum Week recently with digital.
We did. So International Museum Week was a Twitter, it's a Twitter campaign. And again, I worked closely with our marketing team to come up with a range of content for every day of Museum Week. It's international, and every day there was a different hashtag. For example, love or people, and that sort of thing. What was really interesting is the most popular elements of the project were really the ones that centered around people. So behind the scenes was really popular. We ran a series of really short interview excerpts with different staff working across diverse parts of the organization, so publications, programming, that sort of thing. And they had to talk about, I suppose, their day at the museum. In obviously it's Twitter, so in a very, very concise format, and they were really popular. We also found that anything that focused on, again, on the NGV as a building, and people's experience, positive experiences of the water wall of the building itself, was really popular, particularly with museums and people internationally who were retweeting that a lot. And also just anyone providing a particular insight into a work of art. So any sort of close-up details of artworks are always popular. Anyone that can provide some additional insight into the works, either from a conservation perspective or an art history perspective, they were also really popular. You know, keeping in mind, of course, that Museum Week, probably its audience are people that are already sort of committed to or interested in the museum sector. But again, we were really impressed and interested by how it was really driven by the art, of course, but the people as well.
Another interesting one is we've got the Whistler painting, Whistler's Mother, on display at the moment. It's on loan from the Musée d'Orsay in Paris, and it's an exhibition centred around one artwork. And really, in the exhibition context, you learn about the artist and his period, his influence on Australian artists, and sort of quite a lot of educational information about the composition of the painting itself before you finally see it. And what's really gained traction on social media is, of course, that painting's been parodied within an inch of its life. And so our sort of social media team sort of drip-fed quite close-up details of the painting that eventually, over a series of nine, you know, that thing, you saw the painting itself rather than, you know, just the same painting in its entirety every single time. And now they're rolling out, you know, the Mr. Bean head or the Star Wars head, you know, someone reading the newspaper. And so to connect that artwork with popular culture, I mean, it's already being done for us, but now it's kind of rolling out into the campaign, connecting that artwork with people more closely.
Over the back, any
questions? It's quite a similar question, actually, to that one just asked. But I'm from a regional area also, and it's one of the biggest shames of living in a regional area is this ease of access to a gallery like this particular one. And so that's why my particular interest is certainly in creating opportunities for this engagement or this gallery experience for those people that really do struggle to make it into Melbourne, particularly young people. I think I really resonate with what the comment you made about the creativity, this idea of another world. And I think children really resonate with that. And if there was that opportunity to bring that into, you know, regional areas, I think it would be a very powerful thing.
Yeah,
and
definitely.
So I guess part of that is, are there conversations around developing applications, perhaps, for NGV, where we can then, rather than just using social media and using the Instagrams, but building these experiences in the digital platform.
Maybe NGV Guide is a good example.
Yeah, and also kids on too.
Yeah. So a couple of things, I guess, that sort of in small ways that we've started to think about that too, because we are really aware that you know, we do have an audience who can visit us, but we're much more interested in being, you know, a broader local, national and international museum, really, and providing that access to anybody. The children and families audience has just exploded at the NGV, and now, you know, we never used to do anything for that audience, and I think museums more generally didn't, and that's changed, obviously, quite dramatically in the last decade or two. And so now we have a rolling program of exhibitions for children at the NGV, and to the point where now we can't not have something on for children and families, or else we do receive, you know, the visitor comments, the comments on social media as to, you know, why there's nothing on. Part of that too has been a regional program called NGV Kids on Tour, where we take, we have an annual summer festival for kids and families, which is a free festival on site, which is held, it's over 10-day period, the last 2 weeks of school holidays. And there's a whole lot of hands-on workshops with local artists or inspired by practitioners who are on display. But a big part of that is also packaging up those elements and sending them out to regional Victoria. And so I think last time out we had about 30 venues regionally who took that program. It's free. In its physical sense, it's a giant box of materials and instructions, both for the facilitators and for the families, and signage and a whole range of things for basically these venues, which might just be a local community centre or a school hall. They're not generally art museums, or, you know, the number of regional art galleries is actually quite small in Victoria as well. So we'd like it to have no barriers, really, to set up. So that's grown in the first year. I think we had 19, and then the second 30. So quite a big jump in the interest, and we get, you know, as soon as one's happened, we get interest for the next one, and it's only held once a year. So that's been a really important one for us, and hopefully that augments, you know, what kids are doing in schools. You know, we do some teleconferencing and things like that, so hopefully it's sort of augmenting that formal learning element that they get. But you know, there's a whole lot more that we can do there, but we hope by, you know, engaging with kids when they're really young, you know, having those experiences that people who grew up in the country didn't have with the physical works, that hopefully, again, we can get them interested in contemporary art as well, because these are artists are living, you know, they're people that they can identify with. They might even think about becoming an artist. It's not like all the artists are dead, like what they used to be when we grew up. It was all Picasso and Matisse, and that was it. but another project is NGV Guide, which Elisha was heavily involved in.
NGV Guide is, I suppose it's a program that we developed quite recently specifically for mobile use. So it's not an app, I suppose it's a web app, it's a mini website, and you can use it in the gallery, but it's, we also designed it so that people can use it and enjoy it remotely as well. And it's based on, again, on building a more personal way of experiencing the collection, but it also incorporates content, for example, audio tours that are spoken by a wide variety of people who don't necessarily work in the arts, and they talk about their favourite works in the collection. A lot of them come from regional places, a lot of them are from Melbourne as well. The genesis of the project actually came from a funny conversation I had with my dad, who, you know, he hasn't been to the NGV in years and years, but he has a very, very strong connection, as many Australians do, with Tom Roberts shearing the rams. And he said, you know, he grew up with a life-size, very beautifully painted fake on his uncle's wall, and so it's always, I suppose he's grown up with this painting. And one thing that we're working towards with projects like NGV Guide, as well as other projects, is looking at, I suppose, creating other experiences and opportunities for people to have that sense that they can either tap into something that resonates with their own childhood, or something that they can access again without having to come into the gallery, but they get not only duplicate content that they might get in the gallery, but they get content that you wouldn't find in the gallery as well, which is quite important for us. Another area I work on is the gallery magazine, and we're quite conscious of utilising a very diverse range of voices in terms of writers and interview subjects as well. And we do talk to people who, again, have had some sort of regional background, and they have very strong memories of coming into the gallery on school excursions and that sort of thing as well. So I suppose it's just about really engaging and being proud of this, the diversity, I suppose, of people that we work with.
Quick question. So you talked about the children and family audience exploding. What sort of came first? So did it, was it a market that was growing externally and you've tapped into that, or was there something that you did to bring them in and it worked well and then you expanded?
Yeah, the latter. So we have, I mean, we've had a very long-standing and very successful education program. So, you know, many thousands of school children will come through the gallery every year. It's very much tied to the curriculum. It might be one visit a year or one a semester, depending on the resources available. And I suppose, you know, the outcomes of those are very prescribed. And we're conscious that, you know, a child might visit with their school, but they can't come to the gallery, you know, on their own, obviously. And so we want them to experience art in all of its facets as well. And you find that, you know, as a kid, you're constantly drawing. Mm. Art's very open and accessible, and everyone's creative. Mm. And then you kind of reach a point, it might be in your teens, that you either pursue it as a career or it completely drops off of your radar. And then maybe when you have children, you reconnect with it again because you're looking for things to do with your young child. You're looking for things that are free. You know, you might come to the collection, but, you know, the young people themselves can't really engage easily with that work. And so it was very much a strategic decision to start really working with contemporary artists and connect young people with their ideas through interactive exhibitions. And so the content is curated especially for kids, but it's always about getting to the heart of the artist's practice, which is actually really hard. Mm. You know, you can pontificate about why they do what they do in a very long label very easily, but to really pinpoint a specific simple idea that can connect with kids is actually much harder than that. So we find that working with artists, it's really, you know, it's really hard for them. And often these exhibitions are the biggest solo projects they've ever done as well. So for instance, we've worked with fashion designers, Romance was born, with Ai Weiwei, for instance, a whole range of artists and designers, and it's a really interesting process. And I think the quality of those exhibitions and the fact that they cost as much to put on as a big other adult show shows that we care about the content and the audience. And they take just as long, if not longer, to put together as well. Yeah, so, absolutely, yep.
Got one quick question on customer feedback, because all through the case study, you know, it's been portrayed, the NGV is very much a customer-centric organisation. Have you got any tips or any creative ways that you get or engage customers to give you feedback? Do you think you're good at it? You know, do you have any stats on what percentage of your customers give you feedback?
Yeah, I mean, we've got statistics through, again, that cultural market research around visitor satisfaction, and it's sitting really high, but again, for us, that kind of doesn't really mean very much. We take, you know, we do get a lot of feedback via social media, and, you know, nothing like that makes you just jump and, you know, get on to rectifying a situation. If someone's in a queue and it's taking too long, or, you know, whatever, they had a bad meal, that we really respond very quickly to that, because it's them telling us directly. We have a range of other formal channels through visitor feedback forms, but what we find with those is often people rarely leave a comment. It's always a complaint. And so it's hard to get really constructive feedback that's not emotionally driven through that process. That process is very good for particular complaints or situations that we can address, but it's sort of not very useful for that broader feedback. And we've recently engaged, sort of a little separately to that, a sort of mystery shop process, where once a month we work with a company who engage people who aren't arts people to come and drop in, and they have a range of things they have to do and assess us on that. And that ranges from them making a pre-visit phone call, through to checking the website, to buying a ticket online, to coming to the gallery. We give them a members card as well. So they use our facilities. They, you know, do they get asked if they're a member for their discount, for instance? They buy something at the retail store, so they eat some food. And then they mark us really, and quite descriptively on every single aspect of that. And I guess that's just one random sort of thing, but that really, again, keeps us on our toes. And one thing we've kind of noticed from that is that, you know, we've got some consistency issues with our customer service to work on. So we have a security team, for instance, and then a team in the retail stores, a team in our front of house, a team in the food and beverage outlets, and that's the sort of consistency of the service is a little patchy. So in terms of, you know, your welcome message and your goodbye message, you know, eye contact, level of information, all of that. And that's been really useful for us to pick up on a few little things we're working on.
It has. It's been interesting, actually, because as Donna said, we have these different teams. But when a person comes into the gallery, they see all of these front-facing staff as the one team, essentially, and so they have the same level of expectation across the board. So it, you know, it has been quite a challenge for us to work with that, and to work towards, I suppose, yes, a consistent strategy with our front-facing staff as well.
And for them to be as, you know, engage with the idea that the visitor's experience is important as we are, because we can do all this stuff behind the scenes and then we put it in their hands. They're often a team of casual staff as well, so their level of engagement might vary quite dramatically. It might be a job that they do on the weekends and that's about it. And so how do we sort of instill in them those principles that we have? And really it's a make or break situation with the audience. If they've had a great day and then, you know, a bad meal at the end of it, or somebody doesn't say goodbye to them, sort of, you know, grunts at them as they leave the front door, that could completely change their perception of the whole thing. So we're very live to that as well.
Donna, that leads to a question around, do you have a strategy for internal audience engagement, or is that in the hands of the traditional HR people?
What do you mean?
You talk there about how do you send them a message.
Sort of. I think we're getting there. And now that we're getting this information, which is a little more tangible, we can actually, and we are, you know, working with lots of teams to implement that, or to actually come up with, for instance, you know, revising our customer service strategy document. Has anyone looked at it, you know, in the last 5 years? It's that kind of thing. And so to revisit where we are now and where we want to get to, you know, so we're definitely doing that at the moment. Yeah, it's been useful.
Really, you've got an arts background, you're also related to that. Is that pretty much representative of the wider employee base at NGV? The reason why I ask that is, and you have, I guess, a good diversity of people in different positions to kind of give you a different view of what really the state of the world, etc. For really non-arts people, for example, like yourself, who, you know, actually been employed in special fine art, etc.
Yeah, we do. And I guess the beauty of the Art Museum is that it reflects a whole range of professions like any other big organisation. So, you know, we have a finance department, we have a publications team, we have an IT team, we have an events team. And actually, I think a lot of the events staff, I'm not sure that they have an arts background. And so what's interesting, you know, people who work in fundraising but come from maybe other non-profit sectors where this is their first time they've worked in an arts institution, and they're really useful to get their perspectives and their questions as to why are we doing this. I mean, I have a fellow colleague who manages our assets and facilities, and she comes from more of a public records background, and it's quite interesting because she knows the kind of corporate side of museums or large institutions inside out, and not so much our particular situation. So it's quite interesting when she has questions which make me think, oh, okay, yes, you know, she'll ask a question about why do we, you know, why is that artist important? You know, very simple questions, and it really makes you start to think about, why we do it.
Pretty loose. I mean, is there a deadline when we need to come up with a new mission or a new brand, or is that just...
This sort of happens over time. So our executive team is around 3 or so years old, 3.5 years old.
So at that time, quite a lot of work was done on sort of recalibrating what the NGV was there for. And some really public outcomes from that were exhibitions like Melbourne Now. And so within that, there was a very big statement about reconnecting with local practitioners who had previously not been included or reflected, you know, in the program itself. They didn't see themselves reflected in the state's collection. So that happened quite swiftly. And then flowing out of that, I guess, a lot of organisational change, which just takes years. I mean, I've been there for almost 2 years. Helen's been there for 9 months, Elisha a year. So we're all really new. And so it's interesting bringing up the rebrand. So we're in the process of a simple masthead rebrand, because a lot of the sort of underlying principles of the NGV have naturally been worked out in the past 3 years. And so this one's really just about updating the look of that brand, simply, so that it reflects a little bit more what we're doing. So it's kind of, a lot of it happens on the fly, and then you write the policy, you know, sort of later. So
once you work out it worked.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. And we're just trying out a lot of things as well, because we do feel like, you know, we're in a time where nothing's being tested, and it's all about trying something new. So really, yes, we can have all of these documents. Obviously, our collection policy is one that we're very strict on, and we know which areas of the collection have gaps, and to actively collect in those areas or reflect, say, for instance, you know, African art, you know, a whole range of other contemporary areas that haven't been. Contemporary art itself was really very new for the NGV 3 years ago, so that strategy itself is very watertight, and a whole range of the other stuff is really sort of trial and error to a degree, and then, you know, what are our core sort of motives really, and matching those.
Audience engagement as a department's very new as well. Donna, when she came on 2 years ago, that was really the beginning of a holistic, cohesive approach to working with the main areas of the gallery that deal with people, essentially, so the communications and the front-facing and the back end as well. So it is, you know, a lot of it is sort of, as Donna said, sort of going with the flow and sort of seeing how things go and how people respond, as well as being agile in order to build, we think, we hope, a better outcome for the audience.
Well, I think our panel have given us plenty of time and certainly put into context a lot of the challenges that we're dealing with in terms of marketing. Certainly our topic, being consumer behaviour, is very much reflected in an audience-facing organisation. I think what you pick up also is that as we move from traditional approaches to marketing to much more consumer-centric, there are, as we mentioned here, new metrics to be encountered. Some of the challenges raised in the questions that you've asked around how do organisations deal with that around their broader organisational goals. I think what we keep hearing from here is what you're learning and experiencing is that if you keep engaging with the audience and there's value, that translates to ticking off the sort of KPIs that you're chasing. So thank you to our three speakers, to our guest panel, to Donna, Helen and Elisha. And we've got Poppy's going to provide some...